Hello all, this is Dr. Alsup, and in this video, we will be discussing the muscles of the posterior compartment of the leg. And this is the last of the muscle compartment videos, and we will be discussing our favorite characters, including innervation and, of course, actions. Okay, recall that the leg is composed of three muscle compartments. We have already discussed the anterior and the lateral compartments, and now we have arrived at the largest compartment of the leg, which is the posterior compartment. It's so large that it's actually broken down into two subcompartments. You're going to have a larger, more superficial compartment, so you can see a lot of those muscles right here in this image, and a deeper and also smaller subcompartment, which you can see over on this side. So this is the deeper dissection, and this is the more superficial. But even here, we've cut some of the superficial muscles. Typically, when one thinks of the calf region, they are thinking of the muscles that compose this larger superficial compartment. The great thing, though, is that both of these subcompartments, so all of the muscles in the posterior compartment of the leg, are going to be innervated by the tibial nerve, which you can see here running along this deep compartment. And so the tibial nerve is that larger terminal branch of the sciatic nerve. And we have something similar going on here as to what we had in the upper limb, with one nerve supplying the posterior compartments. I hope you remember my kind of chant, radial nerve equals posterior. Well, in the lower limb, the tibial nerve mostly equals posterior, except in the gluteal region. So tibial nerve, I want you thinking, equals posterior compartments, except for the gluteal. Recall in that posterior thigh region, it's the fibers from the tibial division of the sciatic nerve that innervates these muscles. So both the posterior thigh and the posterior leg, be thinking that tibial nerve. Okay, let's get into the separate subcompartments. And just of note, these subcompartments are actually separated from one another by an intermuscular septum. So there is a clear division here. It is the superficial subcompartment that really forms the prominence of the calf, as at least the two dominant muscles, the gastrocnemius and the soleus. These are the two major muscles here. The plantaris is also a muscle within this compartment, and you can see a little bit of its tendon right here. But as it is not a particularly dominant or powerful muscle, we aren't going to any more details regarding the plantaris. The gastrocnemius is the more superficial. It's been cut on this image, but you can see the full gastrocnemius right here. And it is going to have two proximal heads or attachments. You can see it separated here, the medial head and the lateral head. And these proximal attachments actually cross the knee joint, so making the gastrocnemius a two-joint muscle crossing both the knee and the ankle, but its most powerful movements are associated with the ankle. It will play a small role in flexion of the knee. The soleus is located deep to the gastrocnemius, and it does not cross the knee joint. So you can see the soleus really well here because the gastrocnemius has been removed. But it's notably flatter than the gastrocnemius and can be palpated on either side of the gastrocnemius. So you can usually quite clearly see the soleus even on a more superficial dissection. The gastrocnemius with its two heads and the soleus are often considered together, and you may hear them referred to as the triceps suri muscle, so kind of a three-headed muscle when you consider these together. They're often considered together because they have similar actions, but also importantly, they share a common distal tendon that you have likely heard of as the Achilles tendon, but the real name is going to be the calcaneal tendon, because it inserts on the calcaneal tuberosity of the calcaneus. So your heel bone region right here is going to attach down there. Now, one cannot ignore the calcaneal tendon. It is easily palpable just above the heel, It is thick. It's often considered the most powerful, strongest tendon in the body. So it is a very, very prominent structure in this region. When discussing the actions in this subcompartment, it is really all about plantar flexion of the ankle joint. Plantar flexion is a very powerful movement. It's more powerful than dorsiflexion, the kind of counterpart movement. And it's important in developing thrust. It's really primarily applied to the balls of the foot, or the ball of the foot, so used to really propel the body forward during locomotion. So if you think standing on your toes, this is going to be plantar flexion. So you have your toes on the ground, and then the hind foot, or the kind of the heel region, is going to be raised superiorly. The muscles in the superficial subcompartment generates about 90% of plantar flexion force. So loss of the gastrocnemius and the soleus in terms of, say, paralysis can be severe in terms of being able to perform plantar flexion. It's very, very important in terms of this specific action. Now let's move on to the deep subcompartment of the posterior compartment of the leg. These muscles are considerably smaller, and I must admit, often quite difficult to discern the differences between the muscle bellies in dissection. So I do want to introduce the names here, and of course talk about the actions, which we will in the next slide, but I'm going to be a little bit less concerned regarding identification. I always get kind of teased. I love all muscles except for the deep subcompartment of the posterior leg, just mainly because it is quite difficult to differentiate these muscles. So the four muscles include the popliteus, which is located in this inferior knee region. If you think your popliteal fossa would be, you know, kind of right around this region, the popliteus is going to play a small role in terms of that boundary. The flexor hallucis longus tends to actually be the largest muscle in this compartment, and it is headed towards the first digit, or the big toe. The flexor digitorum longus is going to have four long tendons that are heading to digits 2 through 5. And lastly, the tibialis posterior is going to be the deepest muscle in this compartment. I think this illustration gives it a little bit more credit in terms of being able to see it. And it's located between the two longest muscles. There are more types of movements that can occur with contraction of these muscles, but many are not particularly strong or play a more synergistic role, such as flexion of the knee with the popliteus and plantar flexion of the ankle for the other three muscles. But there are a few unique actions I want to touch on. There is a tibialis muscle in this subcompartment, and we know all tibialis muscles will play a role in terms of inversion. So the tibialis posterior muscle will work with the tibialis anterior muscle of the anterior compartment of the leg to invert the subtalar and transverse tarsal joints. So kind of moving that sole of the foot more medially. Or that medial portion of the foot is being raised more superiorly. Additionally, the two muscles with long tendons, the flexor hallucis longus, sometimes you hear hallucis, either way, and the flexor digitorum longus will flex the joints of the digits of the foot. So those MP, PIP, and DIP joints, similar to what we had in the hand. Most excellent. I know you may not believe it, but these are the last muscles you will be learning in this unit, and really in terms of your first year, and with anatomy specifically. Who knew there were so many muscles in the body, but they keep us going, keep us moving, and so it's important to consider them. I thank you for your time and attention here, and have a great rest of your day.